Welcome back to OpenLine. We're talking about the effects of preemption here in Nashville and really across the state of Tennessee. And that's, of course, when the Metro Council passes something, the state legislature basically overrules it. We have with us Ann Barnett with Stand Up Nashville, Colby Sledge with Metro Council, District 17. And let's go to Reverend Fuzz. Hello, Reverend Fuzz.
Hey, Ben. Thank you.
Yes, sir. What's on your mind?
I want to ask, just like your other guests, you talk about this, and the lady, she stand up, she mentioned about how, what do you call them, super PACs can influence things and how big companies influence our legislators, and that people, when they voted against the big corporations or the super PACs idea. But the point that I'm trying to make is that people don't vote. How different could things be if people actually voted above this, like, 30% turnout, 35%? What if we turned out 60% in local elections? How different things would be. And so why couldn't our focus, I keep saying, be on getting people out to vote rather than so much of the talk about getting people registered to vote? Why register if you're not going to vote? And I've got to ask Colby this because somebody said it, that one example would be the scooters in Nashville, that the council didn't make all of them leave, and they said it was because every council member received a donation from the scooter companies. I'm not saying myself, I'm just saying I'm going to ask, do the scooter companies and companies contribute to our local elected officials in a way that causes them to support and be more supportive of the ideas that's coming from these corporations and big business rather than the concern of the citizens of the state? I just read an article that said America's gross national product is 75% private compared to somewhere like South Korea where it's like 50% private. And so South Korea provides health care and, you know, lots of socialized things. So that's some of my ramblings, if you could reply.
All right, I'll cut through some of that. All right, what about the scooter thing?
So I'm not aware of the companies contributing to folks individually or whatever it might be. In case people aren't aware of what the limits are that people can contribute, in local elections like ours, an individual can contribute up to $1,600 for an election. A PAC can contribute up to $8,100. So we see here all the time from companies with a variety of interests who will come to the council and say, hey, we would like to see X or Y. I think what we saw on this scooter issue, quite frankly, is it's a 50-50 issue. You either think they're all right or you really hate them. So I'm not sure that one in particular was influenced, but we do see, like Reverend Fuzz is talking about, there is a larger impact that an organization can have versus, say, an individual donor.
Right. Yeah, a PAC mm-hmm. can give a lot more money.
Yeah.
And $8,100 in a council race, that's significant.
Can be very significant. Mm-hmm.
His other question was about why can't we just get more people to vote? Mm-hmm. We talk about registering, or we talk about, you know, what we're talking about tonight. He says, what if we had 60% of people vote, which sounds extraordinary when you consider we're about to vote on Thursday and nowhere near 60% is going to vote, even with
go
early
vote
voting.
On Thursday.
Yeah, so please do go vote.
Yes.
But what about what he's saying there about just voting?
I think that's absolutely important. I think that voting is incredibly important. I don't think that it's the only way that folks should think about becoming civically active. I feel like I've said this before on this show already, but just really getting together with folks in your neighborhood and talking about issues and going to council folks or going to local organizations and really trying to work to create solutions is another way that we can become civically engaged. And a lot of the times that's what it takes for folks to start paying attention to elections. When elections happen and folks don't realize how they impact their lives or don't see how it directly impacts their family or their paycheck or whatever, folks really don't think about voting. And so that's part of all of our jobs is to go out and talk to our neighbors about what's going on in the city and invite them to come in and help us out.
And look, voter suppression is a real thing. I mean, a previous caller, Joe, was talking about lawsuits against the state. There's a lawsuit right now by several different nonprofit organizations who are doing voter registration drives, and the state legislature passed a law to penalize those organizations if they went above a certain threshold of erroneous or applications that had a mistake on them. So when people see that, I mean, I think it's a very real context to think that people get disillusioned. They think their vote's not going to count. They think they're going to go to the polls and they're not going to be allowed to vote because they see what their state legislature is doing. And oh, by the way, who's going to be footing the bill for that lawsuit with the state as a defendant? We as taxpayers.
Do you, and I guess just today, the Speaker of the House released a statement about an executive order that was done by Mayor Briley. It had to do with immigration. Do you think the state, again, is getting more and more involved in local issues? Do you think they should stay out of it? Do you think they should interject themselves in things like that? Or what do you think when you see that happening?
So this is another great example, because I was a co-sponsor of legislation a few years ago when we were talking about basically not turning our local sheriff's office into federal immigration enforcement, right? We did not pass legislation. We considered it in council, but then ultimately withdrew it because we got so much pressure from the state legislature. Did the state legislature then say, okay, you've backed off, we'll do the same? No, absolutely not. They passed the state ordinance or state law preempting any city basically from even considering legislation like that, and then took it even further and tried to weaponize all of our local law enforcement into federal immigration officers. And I think a lot of times, I saw the speaker's comments today, I think a lot of times what gets thrown about is, you know, if you do this, we're gonna consider pulling funding that you get from the city. And I think the speaker mentioned something like 15% of the city's funding comes from the state budget, the state legislature. Well, I think what gets left out there is that we as municipalities, there are state sales taxes that then get remitted to the state from when somebody's down on Lower Broad and enjoying a few beers, you know, state sales taxes are going into the state coffers. And Davidson County pays 15% of the state sales taxes. They occur in Davidson County. And we're not talking little amounts of money. I mean, we're talking $1.4 billion last year. So I understand that there's a little two-way street when it comes to revenue, but I think that we need to understand that our cities, we are not doing things just because we think they're entertaining. We're doing things because we think that our residents are asking for those and they're in the best interest of our residents. And we've created, obviously, a city with the lowest unemployment in the country. We must be doing something right.
It just seems like, I guess, the divide everywhere, all over the place, is fairly significant right now. But the tension or the divide or whatever you want to call it between our city and the state legislature seems pretty wide right now as well. And so then I would ask, okay, many of those state lawmakers would be very upset if the federal government came in and made demands of Tennessee. Do you think that could happen more? If we're seeing that, and you said it's happening in other states where the state legislature is bigfooting certain municipalities, will you see the federal government, should it become blue, come in to some of these red states or vice versa and start doing some things to states? Is that even something that you would push for?
I don't really have a comment on that, but I just, can you imagine what our state legislature would do if the federal government came in and said, you now have to dedicate a ton of your police officers to become environmental, you know, to become environmental regulators, to chase down companies who, and monitor them, see whether or not they're breaking environmental laws, right? Our state would go crazy over that. So for me, it's really just, I mean, you're right, the divide is super wide, and it's all about politics. It's not about what's coming up, what's going to be the best for local residents or coming up with solutions. It's all about politics and which side you're on and what kinds of things we're trying to push.
Well, and sometimes it's not even a side per se. You know, the state right now is once again, lawmakers are challenging basically federal asylum law and couldn't even get our own state attorneys to take up the case or the AG. So they went out and hired outside counsel to spend a 3-year battle against the federal government, which they have lost every step along the way because they don't think that we should be taking in refugees who are seeking asylum. So it already happens. The federal government obviously already puts requirements on us, and it doesn't matter if it's red, blue, or purple. And some of those requirements could be onerous sometimes, and some of them are so that we're not drinking lead in our water.
Mm-hmm. So yes, it's already happened. All right, so we will take a break. We'll come back. If you want to call, there's the number, 615-737-PLUS, 615-737-7587. Take a break. Be back right after this.